so pleased to not only introduce, but welcome back our speaker today. Professor Alitto has spoken here in the past when I did a national conference on Asian studies in 2008 in Chicago. He was our keynote luncheon speaker, and he's been a very good friend to the college. And he's an associate professor of history at the University of Chicago. He's especially interested in the connections between the political, social, and intellectual cultural realms. He was in China during the Cultural Revolution, and I'm going to just turn the program over right now to Professor Guy Alitto. Please give him a hand.
Thank you, Professor Krasman, for that generous introduction. Professor Krasman said, when he invited me to speak here, that since this was the 50th anniversary of the Cultural Revolution, we should have some event. So one of the important questions that I'm asking is, well, how should it be remembered as a historical event? But the second question, the one that is puzzling and impossible to answer, is how did Mao Zedong, who throughout his career was the most practical of all politicians, end up leading the two most impractical movements in, I would say, human history, namely the Great Leap Forward and the Cultural Revolution? My own answer to this, of course, comes at the end of this talk, but I will note that the usual answers are, the usual answers are as follows, that he willingly sacrificed Chinese economic growth, modernization, etc., to realize his utopian socialist ideal. The second is it was pure power struggle. That is, he was out of power to a certain extent anyway, and the Cultural Revolution was all about getting back into power. Of course, Mao was never out of power in the usual sense, but let us review the series of events that took place that led to, okay. Oh, yes, I should first say, how was he practical? Throughout his life, he defied Moscow's directives. He defied Marxist-Leninist orthodoxy for practical purposes. The first and most dramatic of these was in 1927 when he presented his report on the peasant movement in Hunan. He essentially said, well, why do we have to mess with the urban proletariat? After all, there's hardly any here in China, but there are a lot of peasants. So why don't we harness their dissatisfaction to gain political power? And that, of course, is the way that eventually the Chinese Revolution went. During the war with Japan, the usual definition of class went by the wayside for practical purposes. I mean, people say, well, wasn't he a great theoretician as well, original and so on? Actually, everything he ever said had some practical side. I think of his most abstract theoretical essay on contradiction, which is 1936 or 37. And in it, he had an immediate political purpose. That is, the party leadership had just announced a second period of cooperation with the Kuomintang, with the Nationalist Party, and a lot of people were against it. A lot of people in the party were against it. So he used this theoretical answer to these objections. It's not just theory. Okay, how did the Cultural Revolution emerge? It all goes back to the next important time that Mao deviated from Marxist-Leninist orthodoxy, represented by the Great Leap Forward, total collectivization, establishment of communes, et cetera, 1958. And this, of course, is followed by literally the worst famine in human history. The leadership of the party, aside from him, although they would never defy him directly, because Mao had been, for a few decades at that point, the undisputed leader of the party. But they got him to retreat on this impossible plan that he had for the Great Leap Forward. In 1959, the Lushan Plenum is a compromise. Mao's only critic, very, very brave critic, Peng Dehuai, is destroyed. That's what Mao got out of it. And the party got out of this craziness that he had put upon the nation as a whole. So the next important event, 1961, the official, well, not exactly official end of the Great Leap Forward, but something like that. Private plots came back. There was a general retreat from a general collectivization, although communes remained. Now, Mao is extremely resentful about giving up sort of day-to-day power that he was forced to do. And he starts a few campaigns to sort of push his point of view, the socialist education campaign, et cetera. But the party in general, the government in general, is dragging its feet. So he starts plotting to gain allies, to basically regain power. The most important ally he had was Lin Biao, the leader of the People's Liberation Army. Now, Lin Biao did that for his own political purposes, of course. None of these people were true believers in any of this stuff, except maybe for Mao. I have a rather cynical view of what their motivation was. So Lin Biao was the first to start this little red book craze, the first to proclaim that the People's Liberation Army was one great school of Mao Zedong thought. Mao disappears for a while in late 65. Nobody knows where he is. There's speculation outside the country, and probably inside as well, that he's dead. Actually, one of the first indications that he wasn't dead was that he cashed a check from Phil Oakes, an American anti-war folk singer who had sent a check to him. a royalties check, because he published some of Mao's poetry in English on the back of an album of his. But his real emergence happens in July of 66 when he swims the Yangtze. Actually, he didn't swim all over, but he did get into the water and sort of mess around in it for a while. He was 72 at the time, although I think of 72 as a mere youth at this point in my life. Nevertheless, it was sort of impressive. And then the major event that, this Cultural Revolution business was proclaimed in May. Nobody knew what it was, so the party went along. Let's have a Cultural Revolution. Little did they know that in August, Mao would pen his own Dazibao, a big character poster. And it said, bombard the headquarters. So suddenly the entire country realized that the real target of this Cultural Revolution was the party itself. It blew everybody's mind. Red Guards had already formed. I think the first unit was formed at the Tsinghua University High School, and then spread throughout the country. Teenagers, primarily. Teenagers who are, of course, the most idealistic part of the population. the most naive part of the population and easily manipulated, and indeed that's exactly what happened. So, to put a sort of dramatic climax to the beginning, Mao reviews the nation's Red Guards in Tiananmen Square. You know, millions of kids show up. He gives them a blessing, and he has a personal words for a particular Red Guard named Song Binbin. Ms. Song had a given name, Binbin, meaning, oh, gentle, polite, etc. And Mao criticized this. Well, you don't want a word, a name like that. You want something more martial, fierce, nasty. And so she changed her name and then eventually led her fellow students into beating to death her school principal. So there Mao is, surrounded by bodyguards, of course. You can never tell what plots could be launched underneath the water there. And here is him portrayed after having achieved this superhuman feat, surrounded by youth, et cetera, in bathing suits. This is an example of Dazibao. It's university campus. Students write large, paste these posters. They're usually criticisms of local people, power holders of some sort or another, authorities of some sort or another. And this is a woodcut, of course, of Mao's famous event of writing, bombard the headquarters. Here is the review of the Red Guards in Tiananmen Square. And here is his second important ally, Jiang Qing, his wife. Jiang Qing was a kind of washed up film actress who caught Mao's attention by sitting in the front row of his lectures in Yan'an during the war. And so the party central committee allowed him to divorce his wife at the time to marry Jiang Qing, only on the condition that she stay out of politics for her life. Well, that changed. It started changing in 1964. She started getting involved. She established her own network, patron-client network, and then proceeded from there to be the hatchet person for the Cultural Revolution. Now, these are the themes, the sets of behaviors, the usual practices during the Cultural Revolution. The first is Mao literally becomes a god. I mean, there's no other word for it. In those rituals that usually featured, traditional sacred heaven and earth, or parents, say a marriage ceremony. The marriage ceremonies then were carried out by bowing, the bride and groom bowing, to a portrait of Chairman Mao. Quite literally, he became thought of as the savior of humankind, quite literally. This all starts, as I said, with the People's Liberation Army, which Lin Biao transfers, or rather transforms, into a great school of Mao Zedong thought. And for this purpose, he takes a collection of little snippets, puts them together in this little booklet, which has a red cover, of course, and that's the school in operation. Here would be an example. I mean, it looks like a Southern Italian religious procession. Here is a statue is being carried in the front and so on. There's no other word for it. And I was really surprised at this. I mean, by the way, I guess I should mention, although I traveled through China during the Cultural Revolution period, much of my information, because of managed hospitality at the time, much of my information comes from these several decades of getting to know hundreds, I don't know, thousands of Chinese and talking about their experiences. And one of the experiences, I interviewed several hundred rural dwellers. The word peasant just doesn't fit in Chinese society. Rural dwellers. Every one of them had a bust. I mean, no matter how poor, they had a bust and a picture of Mao Zedong. This was after the Cultural Revolution, but it had become a religious fixture in the home. So the other thing is, I still remember reading reports in the Chinese press about, this group of surgeons had reattached a detached hand for someone, and it worked, more or less. Why? Because of Mao Zedong's thought. That is, all of these magical successes were ascribed to using Mao Zedong thought. Our pipe manufacturing factory had a great increase in production, all because we used Mao Zedong thought. What is Mao Zedong thought? It's truisms. It's the equivalent of a stitch in time saves nine and other such things. And nothing in particular to distinguish it from that. And there we have the entire population reading, and the entire population holding up the talisman, the magical talisman. This too reminds me of certain religious practices. One of the central and most noticeable features of the Cultural Revolution was its anti-intellectualism. If you had to name a class that really suffered the most during the Cultural Revolution, it was anybody with an education. And secondly would be the party leadership, but especially the people with educations. Specialists of any sort, intellectuals of all kinds, teachers, technicians, writers, they were publicly humiliated, they were tortured, essentially. There were famous postures that they had to adopt during the Cultural Revolution that some of you might have heard of, such as the airplane posture, where you'd stand for hours, you see, airplane, in that position, thus torturing yourself. You know, sent to the niopeng, the cow pen, the cattle pen, for detention and general torture. Schools, of course, ceased functioning. Teachers had lost their authority. Some of them were beaten to death. Some of them were just sent down to the countryside for re-education, et cetera, et cetera. But one of the great losses that Chinese mention even today is that's an entire generation that suffered from lack of education. Oh my God. So I'll just let it ring. I didn't turn it off. Here are some examples of this. An intellectual being, you know, these signs are essentially shaming signs. These hats, these long pointy hats, dunce hats, are the same thing. So in this picture on the right here, this is a Fan Geming Fenzi, a counter-revolutionary type, and his name, personal name, is crossed out. In traditional China, when that happens, and it means execution. In this case, not necessarily so. Another example of exactly the same thing. So the subject of this struggle would be, you know, to put up, well, as in this case, on a table. Everybody would curse him as a evil, you know, cow-headed monster, or there's a whole list of terms that was used. And you'd be forced to bow or adopt in various uncomfortable positions. And eventually, usually be sent down to the countryside, but not necessarily. Everybody was, with an education, was sent down to the countryside. There he is. The way that they were kept is in the so-called cattle pen. Those are examples of the cattle pen. And there were, of course, plain old executions, even outright executions of entire families in 1970, which was not known, I think, until very recently. So we had this type of thing. A group of teenagers would, you know, I often think that why was there so much destruction, physical destruction of everything in sight, including people, during the Cultural Revolution, is because teenagers who are biologically programmed to do stuff like that, and is vandalism and so on, were authorized by the supreme political, spiritual authority in the land, go forth and do teenage stuff. And that's exactly what happened. So all of those resentments that I guess teenagers have when they reach that time of life were expressed in the absolutely horrifying events. I keep on thinking that not all the deaths were through hacking to death or absolute execution or beating to death and so on. Some of them were just by maltreatment. A friend of mine's father was the principal of a high school in its Oping County in Shandong province. Well, of course, he was an evil authority, academic authority. He was sent to work in the countryside. In that process, it had to do with tree. Anyway, he broke his pelvis. Nobody in the entire county would touch him. He just lay there. He would have died, except that his small son and wife somehow got him into a position where he could rest. And that was the only way that he survived. This would be very typical of these indirect deaths that were caused. And then, of course, the most dramatic was, at least in Guangxi province in the southwest, the actual eating of hearts and livers of class enemies. I think it only happened in Guangxi. At the time, the Western press, or the foreign press, picked up on the theme of the Cultural Revolution, of the destruction of the four olds. That is, it resulted in a cultural desert. I remember traveling around, going to the biggest bookstores in Beijing, Shanghai, and Canton, and finding nothing except Marxist-Leninist classics, the works of Mao Zedong, the works of Lu Xun, and then some strange things. For whatever reason, some American student wrote a master's paper on Shay's Rebellion, you know, the whiskey rebellion in early American Revolutionary Times, and that was translated into Chinese because it was interpreted as a peasant revolution. So you found that in bookstores, and not too much else. There was one novelist who was still being published, Hao Ran. Aside from him, there is nothing. Because the old artists, writers, etc., were driven to suicide, outright destroyed, or were afraid to do anything, of course. So we have this interesting phenomena of the model operas that Jiang Qing personally approved of, created by committee, of course, that everybody in the entire country had memorized before this period was over. Because that was the only thing you could watch. It was like Rocky Horror Picture Show, you know, where the audience chants the lines prior to their being delivered. It was like that for all of them. the first time I heard one of these quotations, what is that? Oh, well, that's because it was from such and such an op. It became part of the language, literally. I was shocked to find that, when I went to Southwest Hunan doing local history research, that in the entire area, there were no old photographs. People, out of self-defense, destroyed whatever pre-liberation photographs that they had. If any of you had seen the film Farewell, My Concubine, you'd see another example of precisely that kind of behavior. That is, anything that could be suspected of being old and so-called feudal was destroyed because you didn't want to get into trouble. One of the in southwest Henan, in the Funiu Mountains. In the 1930s, a so-called local bully had built an electric generator. He was, basically a local reformer, but, titled local bully. Way up in the mountains, when I went to see it, we must have been in a four-wheel drive vehicle for an hour, and then we walked, guided by some old guy who knew where the thing was, for another half, and I climbed. And that, too, had been destroyed, and the various pavilions that had come. Somehow, the Red Guards were able to withstand the hardship of getting to this remote place just to destroy something. And throughout the country, of course, they're traveling around there, you could see, say, in Chufu, Confucius's hometown, the remains of people buried in the Confucian grave were dug up. Actually, so were the early Jesuit missionaries. Their remains were dug up and desecrated. And throughout the land, stone steles, that is, these stone tablets, memorials of something, and they had calligraphy on them, were all destroyed, broken in two. You go to China now, and you see them, but they've been basically patched together, and very few remain whole. And these things went back, 1,500 years sometimes. So, and even in the village level, I mean, I lived in the Chinese villages for an extensive period, and one of the villages I was living in had this memorial to some local Taoist priest, a stone stele, and it was also destroyed. So the theory is, we're going to destroy the old world and create a new world. That was the idea. So we burn everything traditional. There's examples of that. And anything that smacks of religion. This happens to be a Christian church. I think it's Old North Church in Beijing that was subject to this attack and desecration. But, Buddhism came in for the same kind of treatment. And these historic, 1,600 years old Buddhist sculptures in these grottos also, as you can see, destroyed. And then there's the usual book burnings. One of the model operas that, in fact, President Nixon saw when he visited Beijing was the Red Detachment of Women. And here, you see Tiananmen in the background you'll notice that people wear some of their ethnic garb to show the unity of all Chinese, no matter what ethnic background, etc. And it's very martial. It always has to do with weapons and fighting and destruction. Now, these were the general themes. Complete equality, except for Mao himself and his cohorts. That is, lifestyles were supposed to be the same, because underlying all of this was Mao's demand that everybody was going to be completely equal. This meant that there should be no professionalizations, specializations, etc., because that led to classes and inequality, lifestyle. So it's not just economic equality, it's equality of lifestyle, quite literally. Self-reliance is an emphasis upon folk technologies, and Red and Expert is an interesting question. This was one of the major tensions involved. Red refers to your political attitude. Expert refers to your actual abilities to do stuff. It was decidedly better to be Red. It would be nice to be both, but it was decidedly better to be Red rather than Expert. I have something else to say about this later. Populism, that is, everything was done in the name of and for, in name, the masses of people. This is a typical populism of, we're seeing certain examples of it recently. Something that certainly, if you read Mao's writings, you don't pick up on any of this. You have to look at his overall policies over those several decades, starting with Yan'an and during the war. Yan'an, the wartime capital of Chinese communism. Philosophical voluntarism, that's not volunteerism, it's voluntarism. That is, the general conviction that sheer determination, that sheer human will can determine everything else, including objective conditions and factors. And he illustrated this by one of the three essays of his, all wartime essays, that illustrates this perfectly, the populism as well as the philosophical voluntarism, is Yu Gong Yi Shan, the foolish old man who moved the mountain. He repeats this folk tale of this old guy who came out of his house one day and looked at the mountain in front of it and said, you know, this really gets in the way. So he takes out a shovel, his sons take out shovels, and they start digging. And so passersby say, oh boy, are you stupid. I mean, you're never going to be able to shovel away this entire mountain. So he replies, well, if I don't finish it, my sons will finish it. If they don't finish it, my grandsons will finish it. Ad infinitum. And that was then rewarded by the gods, by having them, the gods, move the mountain for him, the foolish old man. Now Mao ends the essay by saying, see, we have something even more powerful than gods. We have 450 million Chinese. In other words, the Chinese masses, any masses, once aroused, this is very traditional China, once aroused and excited, can accomplish anything. That was in back of the Great Leap Forward. That was in back, certainly, an assumption during the Cultural Revolution. The rural emphasis, well, you can more or less figure that out. There was a decided, organized effort to transfer as much of the urban population to rural areas as possible, especially young people. They're going to go down to the countryside with their knowledge of being, you know, high school students or university students, share that scientific knowledge with the masses, and then become, rural dwellers. Right? This entire image of, complete equality, complete, you know, self-reliance, complete virtue was exemplified in the May 7th cadre school. It just means that on May 7th, Mao said, let there be these kinds of cadre schools. That's why they're called May 7th cadre schools. They are essentially sending urban professionals down to the countryside to shift for themselves. They make everything by themselves, and they work as the masses work. This, of course, as with the case, in the case of the sent down youths, the educated youths who was sent to the countryside, was economically disastrous. And you talk to many people, oh my God, that guy who was, you know, the sent down youth didn't know anything about farming. I talked to other people, and said, yeah, I was in this village and I raised pigs. I raised to death 4 pigs. And that was very clear. Most of the time, these sent down youths were considered a burden, an economic burden, because they had to be fed no matter how incompetent they were. The May 7th cadre school that I visited was perhaps the most famous. It was Naniwan, south of Yan'an, you know, the wartime capital. And at the time, the architects of the cities in the area and the physicians of the cities in the area were down there, well, farming and so on, and they were doing for themselves. For instance, the architects were building houses. Now, I have to say that I was absolutely, you know, they were laying bricks and so on. They knew nothing about laying bricks. Those buildings that they were constructing were certainly going to leak at the very least, or collapse at the very worst. And the doctors especially, see, we constructed our own operating table. That is, they did carpenter work. You touched it with your finger and it started to sway. It is not exactly the kind of ideal operating table that anybody would want. But that was the ideal being fulfilled. In back of all of this is this anti-rationalization, that is, rationalization in the sense of efficiency-ization that underlies modernization in the Weberian sense, anyway. It is to say, higher civilizations get that way through specialization, special social and economic roles. And Mao was basically against it. One wonders what his ideal society would have been like. He could only equate it with the Taoist ideal society. Where, okay, so back to the question. This is my answer, an adjunct to the usual answers. When in Yan'an, was this town of 10,000 at the time, very small town, in the middle of the poorest, most backward, most isolated part of China proper. That's where the party ended up after the Long March. Now, Mao, in my view, simply made a virtue of necessity. Those features, those qualities of the Cultural Revolution were prefigured in the Yan'an period. And every one of those was Mao making a virtue out of necessity. Examples. This would be the example of the success that the Chinese Communist Party experienced during the war. It got back into the political game after being on the verge of extinction. And these figures would be sort of good examples of how dramatic that rise was. And of course, from that, they end up winning the Civil War and establishing the People's Republic of China. So I think that Mao's vision of the good society was born then. It was, by the way, perhaps the only period in which the Chinese Communist Party enjoyed honest-to-goodness popular support, that is, during the war with Japan. Most of China, when it was the Tuli Gaige, the land reforms and other things, had that done under the guns of an occupying army. It was not popular, but it was enforced from above. So this cluster of values, techniques, etc., that he had used resulted in this miraculous success. So I think that for him, this became his vision of the good society, a transcendental entity that when he was in complete control, as he was during the Great Leap Forward, well, anti-rightist campaign, Great Leap Forward, and the Cultural Revolution, he tried to sort of foist the virtue that was born of necessity off onto the entire nation. In other words, well, you can see, Maoism was great for seizing power, but a disaster for nation building. My goodness, did I run over time? I did run over. I didn't? Oh. So, I'll give you examples of how I see all of the features of the Cultural Revolution, all of the features of Maoism. I mean, not Maoism in the sense of prolonged armed struggle to gain political power. That's what the press often terms as Maoism. It isn't. I mean, the Naxalites are often mentioned, and in India, are often mentioned as Maoists. The Nepalese Communist Party is often mentioned as Maoist. The Sendero Luminoso, which no longer exists in Peru, also mentioned often as Maoist. That's not what it is. His vision of what society, the good society should be, had very little to do with that aspect. Well, it did, because it was instrumental in getting power. But the important thing is that, say, during the war, class struggle was put to the side. Why? Because of the practical purpose of trying to attract support from, well, the entire population, including the elites. However, this process of becoming proletarian internally, of going through a moral drama in your soul between the forces of light and the forces of darkness, was central. And it's at that time that you have the first, well, not the first, the important party purge that takes place, and it's all on the basis of changing people's thought. This egalitarianism, well, why is that virtue out of necessity? Because this was a party of the proletariat in the middle of a place where there, for hundreds of miles, you couldn't find a proletarian. And a party that was made up of essentially young intellectuals. Very few actual proletarians in the party leadership at that time. So what are you going to do? Well, you change the definition of what you mean by class. You subjectivize it. You make it some an internal condition. And this, although never articulated, was certainly true, that is, wushanjieji, the Chinese term for a proletarian, became a state of the soul, became a kind of condition whereby your thought was correct. See, suxiang in Chinese, the word for thought, is more complicated than the English one, but I won't go into that right now. I just thought of an example. Once on a train, going back to Beijing from Shandong, I was in the same compartment as this old lady professor. Of course, she wouldn't be old to me now, but at the time she was sort of old. He was a professor of French, by the way, Professor Liu. And I'm doing research on Liang Shuming. Liang Shuming was this famous intellectual who has, especially in the last several decades, become extremely famous. But Mao had criticized him in the fifth volume of his selected works. So we discussed Liang Shuming, and she said, yeah, so Chairman Mao thought that only he was proletarian. Get it? Proletarian has nothing to do with being an industrial worker. It has to do with your being correct and your soul being in the state of grace. And so that expression would be, that kind of expression would not have been made without the assumptions throughout the population of what being a proletarian meant. So, you're without proletarians, let's make proletarianism a state of the soul. Makes sense, it's a virtue out of necessity. Egalitarianism, that place in the north, west of China was so poor, there was simply not the material available to differentiate much between classes in terms of material consumption. It really is that simple. Self-reliance, they had to be self-reliant. They were without modern technologies. They were without practically anything. So naturally, one of the major slogans during the Yan'an days and during the Cultural Revolution was self-reliance. Populism, that explains itself. Well, are objective factors. And we don't have modern arms. We're fighting the Japanese. We don't have modern anything. But we do have people. And that resource we can control. And we can change their consciousness through education. And consciousness, as I guess I didn't mention this previous, consciousness in Orthodox Marxism, historical materialism, is determined by social being, social existence. That is what you are, what you do in society, is what determines your thought. Mao essentially puts that on its head. He says that consciousness, the proper Suzhang, can determine your social existence. Very, very important change. And for whatever reason, because people take his writings literally, and it's all in Marxist-Leninist terminology, they usually don't see it. Voluntarism, well, again, we have to be devoted to this doctrine of will, because we have nothing else. We have to rely upon determination. We have to rely upon the will to overcome these. It's one of the few resources that we can control. Well, morale and morals, it's in effect something that you could control through education. So there was always this emphasis upon changing consciousness through education, the small study groups and so on. This was all intensified during the Cultural Revolution. The rural emphasis is, of course, obvious. Well, actually, rural areas are the seat of all virtue and wisdom, not a modern factory in a city. Actually, modern cities are sinkholes of depravity in Maoist vision. So is that? Yes, that is it. So I am now open to questions.
Are you saying that the Cultural Revolution is the extension of the Yan'an period?
Yes.
That he wanted to recreate?
Yes.
A fantasy
world? Exactly what
world.
I'm saying. Yes.
Okay. I got it.
Okay. And I've given lectures in Chinese about this topic, and this simply is beyond people. Oh, my God, that can't be. I've given similar talks about the Cultural Revolution here in the United States, and the various radicals who were in high school during the time show up and say, no, Mao didn't sacrifice economic growth, etc. That was a great period of economic growth. Well, precisely the opposite was true, but you believe what you want to believe. And one of the reasons is that it is only China in the entire world, in the non-West anyway, who tried to jettison its past, actually several times. And I'm thinking of the New Culture Movement, the May 4th era, and then the Cultural Revolution. It was an attempt, for reasons of nationalism, to detach, to destroy the Chinese past, the Chinese culture. That makes China unique in world history.
Doctor, over here.
Yes.
The children, young adults of the Cultural Revolution, they must be in their 60s or 70s. Do they have any guilt for the crimes or actions of those years?
Yeah, that's very complicated. Some people have. Other people simply still defend themselves. Well, we thought at the time it was all good. And of course, everyone thought this was sort of wonderful. We're going to create a new world, a new socialist man, and so on. There have been confessions of sorts. That woman I mentioned, Song Binbin, for years, she denied any guilt that she had had over her actions. But then, I guess it was 2-3 years ago, she finally did acknowledge, hey, that wasn't too good an idea to have our principal beaten to death and all. But that's a very good question, but it is extremely complicated. I have to go through my many conversations with many people. No, there is no such thing. See, when the Cultural Revolution was over, that is, with the fall of the Gang of Four, since the fifth member had already died, namely Mao, Deng Xiaoping, who had, for the second time, gotten back into power, had consolidated that power by late 1978, and that was the beginning of the reform period. So, at that point, Deng Xiaoping and the leadership wanted everyone to talk about the Cultural Revolution, how bad it was. And for that was true for maybe 2 years or so. And then, precisely because of the horrific acts that were uncovered, that the party decided, no, we don't really want to think about that anymore. So, in the Museum of National History in the Tiananmen, there's a very small corner devoted to the Cultural Revolution. It's now downplayed. People get into trouble. One of my students was detained doing research. This was some years ago, but he was detained for doing research on the Cultural Revolution. And so to this day, the untoward aspects of the Cultural Revolution are being essentially denied. That is.
Can you say that this brought equality, that this revolution brought equality among the classes?
No. That's the interesting thing. We all thought, we leftist Westerners, I thought, oh, yes, this is the Soviet Union, of course, has formed classes, but the Cultural Revolution will certainly result in a classless society. That didn't happen. It's just that, you know, making certain political noises gained you elite status. And it was taken advantage of in exactly the same way. Many of the executions that took place after the Cultural Revolution for crimes during it had to do with, for instance, sexual exploitation, because Red Guard leaders would essentially make a harem of their followers and so on. One of my friend's sons was executed for that, for instance. It was relatively common. There's still a shuffling of, a concrete example I just thought of. We thought that the People's Liberation Army, because they stopped for a while using insignia of rank, the army's completely, no. I remember it distinctly. I was on a train, and a PLA officer dropped his gloves by accident, and whoever he was, the adjutant, scurried to pick them up and present them to him. Actual equality was not. The final result was this dog-eat-dog, I guess you'd call it capitalist society that you see at present, which is super class divided. Sorry to disappoint. And
Thank you.